Lisa.
And I'm Nick, and welcome to Under the Covers with Lisa and Nick.
So our next guest has his first book coming out in a mere matter of weeks. So we're really excited to be joined by, I would say, one of Australia's leading entrepreneurs. He is a bit of a crazy cat. He's the co-founder of Catch, Scoopon, EatNow. He's a tech investor. He's actually invested in Fiverr, which I didn't realize. So welcome to Under the Covers, Gabby. Oh my God, I'm going to stuff up your name. Leibovich.
Thank you, Lisa.
You had time to practice and you didn't practice.
Welcome, Gabby.
Great to be here with you, listener Nick, especially under the cover on this cold and windy morning day.
Yeah, it's warm under here.
Mate, yeah. It's good to have you on board. And should I say congratulations or commiserations on the sale of Catch pre-COVID?
Thanks, Nick. I was waiting for that one.
I was like, I've got to get this one in straight away.
You hit me with that. But any person that I meet and walk around the park, I tell them, look, we sold the business at an amazing price and we've built an amazing business. But it is true that the business that we sold in August 2019 is worth today probably 10 times that price. Congratulations to West Farmers for buying a tremendous business that will keep on leading the market for hopefully generations to come. And they got a bargain thanks to Corona, and good on them for spotting the opportunity.
Yeah, diplomatic answer. Well done.
It's the truth.
Yeah.
How come you sold Catch out of interest?
Sorry?
How come you decided to sell Catch out of interest?
Look, we started the business literally in the garage in 2004, selling on eBay. In 2006, we started selling online under Catch of the Day, that later on rebranded to Catch. We've been doing it for 16 years, Lisa. It's a long time. I just turned 50 last month. I started it when I was 34.
It's so young.
You know, I look 25. Oh, I'm a pretty cool guy wearing Australian open hats and everything. But it is a long time, and it's a very stressful period to do this day after day after day. And you know, we got what we believed at the time was a very fair price. We were ready to check out, and we always thought that we don't want to be the richest people in the cemetery, and I don't want to be a Jerry Harvey also being very angry at the age of 80, trying to run my business. I think there's a lot more to life than it's just chasing growth.
Mate, absolutely. So when you sold the business, how did it make you feel? Were you ecstatic? Were you a little bit sad? What were your emotions?
Look, from the moment that West Farmers approached us and showed keen interest in the business till the time of exit was almost a full year. So it was a full year of emotional roller coaster, realizing what it is. But there was definitely a lot of tears shed. And I remember, driving my car from my little driver here on the last moment as I was driving to Catch. And I was just sitting in my car on my own, and I just started crying. It's saying goodbye to my family and kids, 200 and something people in the office, a baby that we've built for, such a long time. I've got the Catch sign behind me here. It's something that I'm very proud of, and it will be my baby for the rest of my life, Sure, we don't own the business, but we'll keep supporting it, and we love it, and we're very proud of what we've achieved.
So how do you go working with your brother? Because, look, Nick and I aren't related, but there's plenty of times where I do want to kill him. and I'm sure that you and your brother, I don't know, maybe you might have not had conflict over the years, but how do you manage that relationship?
I'll start with an interesting line that's in a book. The book is, by the way, called Catch of the Decade, out in the market on the 1st of November. Number one right now in the Booktopia business category.
Woo-hoo, well done. We'll put a link to the book in our show notes as well.
That's right. So chapter three in the book starts with the following line, basically us trying to explain how two brothers managed to do that together. Our first employee, Vijay Bala, said the following line after 10 years. He said, this business would not have succeeded with two Gabbies or with two Hezis. And it needed one of each. And it is true, just like you want to kill Nick every day, me and my brother want to kill each other every single day, until today, even now that we are so-called retired and doing different things. But you know what? You need different views of the world, and everyone needs to bring something else. For example, my brother is not interested in doing any PR for the book. He's never done a podcast in his life, and I couldn't even get him to put a message on LinkedIn to announce the book. He's very private. He's very quiet. But at the same time, is a lot better than me in other areas. For example, technical and SEO and SEM and so on. So he knows when to let me lead, and I know when to let him lead. And somehow together, we seem to have done a few good things. Saying all that, we succeed together, but we also fail together. But at least it's a lot nicer to do it with someone than doing it on your own. I wouldn't like to launch a business on my own. And we do talk about that in the book, that we much prefer doing it in two and sometimes three, you know.
Hey, that's fantastic. And so you sold Catch in 2019, and I believe you were involved in Menulog, which is, to me, the greatest deal in Australian history. Yeah. Can you talk us through that, if you don't mind?
Absolutely. So in 2012, we spotted an interestingly growing space, which was food ordering online. Today, we all know what it is, and today we all use it a number of times a week, and we all know who the market leaders are. But back in 2012, most people still called, Gino's Pizza and ordered the pizza on the phone and went to pick it up or wait for the driver to arrive. At the time, there was only one company in Australia doing it, and that was Menulog. And they probably started about 7 years earlier in Sydney. Initially, they started doing it by phone, and then they moved to spreadsheets and so on. And we were lucky enough to have an amazing database of two previous companies that we've built, which was Catch of the Day and Scoopon. Oh, yeah. And we went to our existing database and told them, hey, guys, why don't you look at this website called EatNow? And we launched a business called EatNow, which we all understand today what it is. It's an app that features all your local restaurants and allows you to order your food online. By 2015, we managed to grow very nicely. And in numbers, we were probably equal to 30% of what Menulog was achieving. And in the book, we talk in many instances about the concept of 1+1=3. Why it's better to team up with your competitor and build a bigger pie or a bigger pizza in this case. And that's exactly what we did. We merged with Menulog in February 2015. As soon as we've merged, we no longer had to compete with them. We were strong in some states, for example, Melbourne and WA and so on. And they were strong in Sydney and other states. And suddenly we owned 95% of the food delivery in Australia. Can you believe it? You know, 95% owned by us.
This is pre-Uber and pre...
Correct.
Yeah.
Absolutely. No one even heard of Uber or Deliveroo at the time.
Yeah.
Anyway, long story short, the business got sold to the English Amazon of food delivery, a company called Just Eat. Just Eat bought America's number one leader right now called Grubhub a couple of months ago. So they are massive in lots and lots of countries. And it sold for the unbelievable price of $855 million.
Unbelievable.
I think it was in May or June 2015. You know, we still pinch ourselves today and don't realize and don't really understand why and how. The BRW reported it as one of the craziest deals of all time at the valuation of 371 times EBITDA.
Yeah. It's unbelievable deal.
Yeah.
Unbelievable deal.
Saying all that, there's a lot of crazy, unbelievable deals right now post-corona as well. So the world is changing and evolving. And it's definitely something that we are very, very proud of. That's for sure.
And then I think 6 months later, after you sold it, I think Uber and Deliveroo came to the market.
That's absolutely right. So timing worked in our favor then, unlike with the Catch deal and corona. 6 months later or so, just like you said, Uber Eats and Deliveroo hit the market and completely disrupted that space. I don't know who owns the market right now. I'm guessing Uber Eats is the leader.
Yeah.
But they're all growing as the pie keeps growing. You know, my house, you know, receives orders, you know, twice a day.
Well done. That's brilliant.
Yeah.
Would you mind taking us through Scoopon? So I first heard about you during the Scoopon days.
Yeah.
I think that was... late 2008, 2009, Scoopon, I believe.
No, it launched in April 2010. So, we've been growing Catch very nicely for 4 years. By April 2010, Catch was officially Australia's number one most visited shopping site, according to Heatwise, that was the measuring tool at the time. And we spotted Groupon being launched in the USA. And Groupon came up with a very interesting concept of offering, you know, discounted restaurant meals, massages, travel, entry to events, which was very similar to what we were doing at Catch. At Catch, we were offering products at discounted prices. We used to buy them in large volumes and sell them at low prices. And my brother spotted Groupon in the USA, and chapter two in the book is starting with the following lines. Hey, Gabby, look at this sign. Look at this site that we launched, that I found in the USA. It's very similar to Catch. And my reply to him was, hey, Chezi, we've seen a lot of shit lately, but this is a really good one. And the title of that chapter is Great Idea by Midnight, Execute by Midday. And literally the next day, my brother stepped out of the building and started building Scoopon from scratch. I continued being, you know, the leader of Catch. I love product and I love the business. At the time, it was, of course, Catch of the day. And my brother was building Scoopon. And I'm happy to say that today, there's only two players in the market left. When we launched, there were about 80 different competitors. Mm. Most of them disappeared. Today, there's two players left, Groupon and really Scoopon and Kudo. We own 50% of Scoopon today, and the other 50% is owned by the Lux Group, the owners of Luxury Escapes.
Yeah,
it's actually interesting that you talk about how quickly that you moved on an idea. And I think that's a lot of... that sense of urgency is something that's really important in the startup world. And I know you do a lot of work with startups. So you do a lot of mentoring, you invest in a lot of startups. So can you just tell us a little bit about why you believe that it's important as a startup to have a mentor? Because that's something that Nick and I both really strongly believe in.
Look, I mean, there's a line that summarizes it that I've learned myself around 2012. And the line is, you don't know what you don't know. And I'm very happy to admit that in 2012, I did not know what CFO stood for. For those that are listening, it's Chief Financial Officer, and most of you should know what it stands for. But in 2012, I did not know. And for that reason, you know, you need to surround yourself with smarter people than yourself. Myself and my brother never pretend to be the smartest people in the room. And if you are the smartest person in the room, chances are you need to move to a different room. We made sure over the years that we need to surround yourself with the best CFO, someone that's much better than us on the financial side, and the best CMO, someone that's much better than us on marketing, and the best logistical person, and so on. And what my brother became, we became the ideas people, the strategy people, the money people, and the people that are very happy to take the risk. But you really need to surround yourself with smart people that have done that before. And there's not much that you can say, but the person at the age of 40 that has worked for 20 years in their space knows so much more than a 24-year-old. It just comes without saying, and that's what it's all about. And so I suppose that's what mentoring is, just learning from someone else's experience. And experience means both success and failure, because I'm just as happy to talk about the mistakes that we have made, and we've made many mistakes.
Do you mentor at the moment, or do you have a mentor yourself?
I do not have a mentor myself, and I've never had one, but I'm learning something every single day. I'm going to learn something from you today, and I'm going to learn something from reading an article on the Financial Review, and something else from reading TechCrunch in the USA. We all educate ourselves every single day, and my brother will show me something interesting that's happening around the world today, and we keep on educating. Mentoring officially, maybe I've got a couple of people that I catch up with, you know, on a regular basis. I never charge for anything. I never charge for events, for participations, for advice, for recommendation. We just do it because we care about the community. We care about growing. And we also believe that sharing is caring. And if you do share, good things will happen to you. Yeah, which reminds me that 100% of our book profits are going to a couple of really nice charities. Please support them. One of them is Goods 360, and the other one is Second Bite. No authors in Australia will become rich from being an author, but it will give us a lot of great pleasure in sharing that story with the community, and hopefully inspire the next generation of entrepreneurs to go and build the next big thing.
Yeah, that's great, mate. Well done. My daughter says to me, sharing is caring when I'm eating a block of chocolate.
And I'm guessing that's where I got it from. It's from, what's his name? Big Bear or something.
Yeah, there you go.
I've got three daughters myself.
Naughty boys get girls.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. So you both must have been
That's what my wife says. God thank you.
Mate, we've talked about your wins. Do you have any losses throughout the journey?
Look, I'll start with the following. Me and my brother, we're not the kind of people that cry about spilt milk. And we all spill a bit of milk here and you make some mistakes and so on. So yes, there's a lot of businesses that we have started and they've actually failed or never got to even launch. And we've probably spent a lot of money trying to build them. Most people haven't heard about them because they never really eventuated into something meaningful.
Mm.
An interesting one that I don't mind talking about is sometime around 2018, early 2018, we went and we spent a couple of million dollars buying the database and trademarks of this company called Pumpkin Patch. We all know that brand.
Yeah.
And we thought that we could take that brand and revive it into something amazing. But we didn't realize that we just don't understand the space of apparel and certainly the space of manufacturing and distributing apparel, which was the key to success of Pumpkin Patch. The specialty of Catch was always about buying end of lines and clearance from existing brands. So we would go to Sony, to Nike, to Adidas, and so on, buy their excess stock and offer it to our consumers. But we don't know how to design clothes, manufacture clothes in Asia, photograph young little kids in our office. To cut the long story short, it was a complete mess, complete failure, and a complete destruction from us concentrating on what we should be. And after a year of trying to do that, we just got rid of it and sold it to someone that really knows what to do with it, a successful company in New Zealand.
That's great.
What's the biggest learning you had from that experience?
Stick to what you know best, which is something that I probably tell young startups every single week. Quite a few people approach us with various ideas for startups. And many of them don't have a clue about the space that they are trying to get into. And my advice is stick to what you know best, because your area of expertise will be the area that you will be able to spot the opportunities, spot the problems, and hopefully be able to also find the right solution.
Mm.
But if you come from, from the bread industry, chances are you will not become a leader in logistics. And vice versa. Most likely the problems in logistics will be solved by logistics experts, those 40-year-olds that have been working in logistics for the last 20 years. You get my drift.
Yeah. Mate, I can see you're not the type of guy to retire. So what have you got cooking at the moment?
I cannot talk about it, Nick.
I know there's something cooking. You can't share the details.
There is something cooking. So the last line in our book goes as follows, and it says, there will always be problems out there, and we enjoy solving problems and coming up with the solutions. And throughout 2020, we've been sitting at home. I've been describing it to someone. I'm a lover of soccer, and I've been describing it as I feel like a retired soccer player watching the best game ever from the sidelines.
Mm.
And the last 6 months has been the best game ever, especially in e-commerce, but generally in digital businesses all around us. And there's a lot of ideas. And as they say, disruption and chaos leads to opportunity. And it's been very disruptive out there. And I'm sure that you are seeing it around you.
Yeah.
So I can tell you that 2021 will be a massive year for launches of new businesses. It'll be a massive year for the investment industry, investing in lots of new businesses. You can see how exciting the share market is, both around us and in Europe and, of course, the USA. Digital businesses are the flavor again, and they're here to stay. You know, e-commerce is not going anywhere soon. It's going to get bigger and bigger, and of course, everything else in the digital space. So I don't think that you've seen the most, the Last of Us, but I can't say anything.
It was a very diplomatic answer and just dancing around the subject.
In politics.
Yeah.
But I'm good at bullshitting, yeah?
Yeah. I think in our line of work, you kind of have to be. Well, just to finish up, we'd love to give you the floor to give us your 1-minute elevator pitch as to why people should buy your book.
Look, the book is called Catch of the Decade. It tells the story of how we've built amazing businesses like Catch, Scoopon, involved in luxury escape, menu log, over a decade. If I am a CEO of companies within those spaces, I would force my employees to read this book over summer and learn from the lessons that Gabby has and Chezi have experienced. We're very honest in the book, just like my conversation with you has been today. We're not afraid to offend people, and we're not afraid to shake the tree a little bit. We all have a lot of time, so might as well go out there and read a nice book and get something into your brain instead of watching another episode of Netflix.
Good one. And I think, you know, for the next generation of entrepreneurs, this is going to be one of those books that becomes a Bible for those people looking to start their own business. So thank you so much for making the time to stop by and hang out with us. I'll put the link to purchase the book in the show notes. And I've already pre-ordered a copy, so I'm expecting it to be signed with a very personal note, hopefully, when it comes in the mail. But thank you so much for your time today, Gabby, and a big congratulations on everything you've achieved today. We look forward to seeing what's next for you. It sounds like you've got some exciting things planned. Look forward to getting you back.
Thanks, guys. It was great being undercovers with you today.
Thanks, Gabby. Take it easy, mate. Thank you.
Thank you.